Hi, I'm Dr. Jack West, medical oncologist at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in Los Angeles. This is Westwind, a podcast focusing on the intersection of cancer care, emerging technology issues in medicine, and healthcare policy. You can find information about subscribing at beaconmedic.com or wherever you find your podcast content. Please leave a review, especially if you like this, and we'd also love to get your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. We'll now continue with my discussion with Dr. Jed Gorden, Director of Interventional Pulmonology at the Swedish Cancer Institute in Seattle, Washington, where we focus on the growing role of interventional pulmonology in the longitudinal management of patients with lung cancer. Let's turn to the issue of a patient who has a highly suspicious nodule and we're in the diagnostic area. Can you speak to some of the issues we have now with the disparities of access to interventional pulmonologists or whatever diagnostic tools are needed to do an optimal workup, and how well are we doing in that process of a good lung cancer workup, both at the leading tertiary care centers and in other areas?
Well, this is a major issue that we face in this country, which is the different levels of care that are delivered and what people have access to. So the first thing is, so I typically refer to people as individuals. Once they have a diagnosis of cancer, then I'll allow them to be a patient. But these people are going through the process, typically need to be asymptomatic, and we're working through individuals through our programs. The notion of how we go about working people up is, it's a major issue. We have tools that exist to acquire tissue in a safe fashion. These tools, whether they're bronchoscopy, which is a camera that passes into the airway, or bronchoscopy coupled with ultrasound, which is a camera that passes into the airway with an ultrasound machine attached to it that can see through the airway wall, identify an abnormality, and you can stick a needle in it in real time. Or navigation tools that allow us to use some electromagnetic fields to navigate catheters to these areas. This technology is available. Its distribution and its access around the country is not ubiquitous. I would argue that our greatest limitation is not necessarily access to technology. It is access to quality decision-making and referring individuals to get a cancer diagnosis. And what I mean by that is, we can still do a quality workup of an individual who has an abnormality using the traditional transthoracic needle biopsy that an interventional radiologist has. We can do it with endobronchial ultrasound. We can do it with tools that we have. While we can improve, we have been able to improve on people's lung cancer diagnosis and staging with modern tools like endobronchial ultrasound or the advancement of clinician training to get certifications for interventional pulmonology or these other designations. I would argue that this is a huge leap forward, but it's not the only barrier to individuals getting care. We have tools. We've had tools for a very long time to make a diagnosis. What we need to have is more conscious workflows and algorithms for taking an individual who may have been identified in an ER or a primary care doctor's office with an abnormality, or an individual who was picked up on lung cancer screening with a new nodule that's suspicious, and get that person rapidly from the diagnostic phase to the active diagnosis phase to a treatment phase. And while technology is out there, I wouldn't say that this is the only limitation. There's a fair amount of data out there that suggests that we have disparities in terms of the access to lung surgery for individuals based on their race or ethnicity, the conversations that are had with them of whether they are even offered surgery vary based on race and ethnicity. So whether race and ethnicity is causal, whether comorbidities are a problem, a lot of our data is based on large data sets where we can't drill into it to better understand what was going on at the individual patient level. But we do know that we have disparities in terms of the discussions that we have, the diagnostic tools that are used, and the treatments that are offered to various and sundry groups of people. And so while I'm a big proponent of us having increased technology, that we use our technology as appropriately as possible, I really feel that we've been dealing with lung cancer for a long time and we've been able to diagnose it for a long time, and that we really just need to work on our recognition, knowledge, and moving forward. I would like to see us all have the latest tools, the latest minimally invasive tools, and be able to offer this to everybody, but I would prefer us have a broader base of education, a more rapid recognition, and a more sense of urgency of moving forward and getting through people through the diagnostic process. I know that's a little bit of a nihilistic view in the sense that technology is an answer for so many things, but I recognize that in our current financial models, acquiring new technology is a challenge, and therefore we really need to use the technologies that we have and maximize them.
You are an interventional pulmonologist, and I know that is a very limited subset of all the pulmonologists out there, but you've also mentioned to me that the definition of what constitutes an interventional pulmonologist is somewhat subjective. So can you speak to this issue and the range of services and perhaps even mindset that's a little different? Because I'll tell you that among the issues that I see are not just that you have a facility with tools like endobronchial ultrasound and navigational bronchoscopy, but also that you have a more longitudinal relationship very often with patients in managing pleural effusions. You are frequently called upon to help out with mechanical issues in our patients with cancer, and just a much more connectedness to a patient with cancer than I think many pulmonologists who might obtain a diagnosis, but then really have little or no role after that. So can you just speak to what you think constitutes the interventional pulmonologist role?
Yeah, so this is an area where I could get myself into a lot of trouble depending on who listens to these podcasts. So, you know, there are societies, there's the AABIP, which recognizes themselves as sort of a society representing interventional pulmonologists. There's been efforts to attempt to standardize this field. So I'm going to give, again, my personal opinion, and this is not reflective of any society, nor is it meant to denigrate any efforts or societies that are out there. But my personal view is that thoracic oncology, lung cancer specifically, was an area that pulmonologists abdicated years ago. This was an area that thoracic surgeons took the lead role in, and medical oncologists were the leaders in giving chemotherapy, and thoracic oncologists were the leaders in doing surgery, and sometimes a radiation oncologist would be called in. Pulmonologists played very little role. When I was in training and fellowship, we saw very little lung cancer because it was referred to either the surgeon or to the medical oncologist. An interventional pulmonologist, in my opinion, or someone who takes an extra effort in fellowship training in an area, should be an individual who is an expert and dedicated to a field of thoracic oncology. While their specific expertise may be a tool, it may be that they do procedures. These procedures need to be done in the service of the patient and in service of the disease, not simply in service of the procedure. Endobronchial ultrasound unto itself is a procedure. Staging of lung cancer is what is of paramount importance. And for me, this is what differentiates a dedicated interventional pulmonologist from a proceduralist. An interventional pulmonologist is someone who is interested in the continuum of care related to the patient with thoracic oncology problems, specifically lung cancer. And when I say that, I mean that we own these individuals' problems and we are there to help them. So the first thing that people often face is a diagnosis and a stage. People who are going through the oncologic process need a quarterback. What we suffer from in this country is that we have isolation and fragmentation in care, and that individuals can be seen in multiple different offices or in the ER, be identified with abnormalities, and then sort of circuitously wander through the process. We can't allow them to wander through the process. We need to have people who take ownership and say, I am your physician and I'm going to help make a diagnosis and stage you. Once we diagnose and stage you, then I'm going to hand you off to your next quarterback who's going to be responsible for coming up with a treatment plan. And it's not sufficient for me just to say, I am your bronchoscopist, because I'm not, I am a bronchoscopist, but I am the individual who is going to be here, educate you, tell you what's going on, and then hand you off to the next step. And this process holds true for the continuum of care, because thoracic oncology is a broad field of individuals who have early stage disease and hopefully a growing pool of early stage disease that we can diagnose, stage, treat, and cure. But it also still, unfortunately, has a large pool of people with advanced disease who have different issues, whether these issues revolve around quality of life and palliation. And I've sort of dubbed this term procedural palliative care. Palliative care is something that should be the standard of care for individuals with advanced stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer. And this has been shown in old studies, but yet we don't use this service. And procedural palliative care is what I think is of paramount importance. If someone has a pleural effusion or recurrent symptom-causing problem, we should come up with a way that is minimally invasive, that doesn't require a lot of follow-up, is low intensity, and allows the patient to maximize their independence and move forward. And so pleural disease is one of these areas. And so an interventional pulmonologist is not someone who does a thoracentesis or drains the fluid. It's an individual that comes up with a strategy that works for that individual. That may be a long-term indwelling tunnel pleural catheter. That may be a serial thoracentesis and they come back on a regular schedule, or it may be pleuridesis. But we have to be willing to own that problem and be the patient's physician and who they think of and who they turn to. That, for me, is the definition of an individual who has chosen the field of being an interventional pulmonologist and an expert and willing to care for people in the space of thoracic oncology, versus someone who's a proceduralist who does lots of procedures and is skilled at lots of bronchoscopy procedures, but is not actively engaged in the needs of the patient. And this is where I think we really need to distinguish ourselves in these areas, that we are part of the patient's care plan until they're handed off to another individual who will take ownership.
So one of the other real changes that we're seeing in advanced lung cancer is an increase in momentum for repeat biopsies that may have a much bigger role in guiding care beyond the initial diagnosis. I would think that having a patient potentially circle back to the pulmonologist for additional biopsies of progressing lesions could facilitate the longitudinal aspect. But I mean, hearing you talk, it sounds like an extra bronchoscopy or two does not the connection make, that it really is, has to be that you have to be somebody who buys into having a longitudinal role, or else you're just somebody who's going to do another bronchoscopy or two over the lifetime of a patient and send them back and be out of it.
Yeah, you know, as you know very well, you know, lung cancer is, in my opinion, is a disease that affects the individual who suffers from cancer and the family that supports them. And so it's an area of great anxiety when people don't have a plan. It's an area of great questioning. What is next? What does this mean for me? And it's very easy to be a proceduralist and say, I'm going to get tissue, but it's your medical oncologist that's going to have a conversation with you about what this means. We need to be able to educate people as we go along the process with all the information that we have, which is honest and real, continues to give people hope, but not false hope. And so that when they get to the next level, they have all the information that they should have at that point. And then the next person gives them the additional information that they have. If someone needs an additional biopsy because of a potential change in their treatment, then an interventional pulmonologist is a perfectly good person to be able to identify what's best for that patient. Because what we often must do is, just because I have a bronchoscope doesn't mean that I need to do a bronchoscopy on every individual. the safest procedure may be another procedure, or the highest diagnostic yield for that repeat tissue may be done by another service. It's my job as an interventional pulmonologist to see the individual, assess the individual, and say, this is what's best for you. It may be from me, it may be from my surgical colleagues, it may be from the interventional radiologist, but really my job as the interventional pulmonologist to say is I'm an expert in getting tissue, getting appropriate tissue, getting safe tissue, and counseling you on what to expect. I may be the individual that does it, but if I'm not the best individual, I need to say that and then refer you to somebody else and then continue to help you through that process until you get to the next person. So repeat tissue biopsying is hopefully something we don't have to do very often, but there are certainly times when treatment decisions require a new, fresh look at the tumor. And we need to then have the courage to say, I am not necessarily the best individual, but I am going to refer you and continue to follow you until we get that tissue and get you back where you need. We need to do, if all we have is a hammer, everyone looks like a nail. We need to make sure that what we're doing is not trying to hammer our own procedures into people, but doing what's best for people.
One other very different view of a procedure to obtain further biological insight is plasma-based testing, and the best procedure may just be phlebotomy. Do you have any sense of the data right now? And, you know, are you thinking that this is going to have a major impact and potentially de-escalate the need for as many procedures that are done by pulmonologists? I know you're not going to run out of work to do.
You know, this is an area I think that's fascinating. And I think that the reach of this is actually fairly broad. So in terms of the adoption of serum-based testing, you know this data better than I do. I think that it's certainly an area of interesting pursuit. I think it's something that is getting better, and it may not be totally ready for prime time in all circumstances. But I think what we need to also remember is that serum-based testing is available to anyone, anywhere. So we talked about this access issue, right? And so if you are in a community that doesn't have access to bronchoscopy and your physician would refer you an hour, 2 hours away in order to get a test, well, perhaps this is a tool that can be used to minimize people's need to travel. We have to recognize that we rob a lot of people of their independence when they get a diagnosis of cancer. They have to fit into our schedule. They have to fit into our infusion center schedules, our clinic schedules, our procedure schedules. The more that we can do that is meaningful, but is maximizing individuals' independence as they go through this journey of lung cancer, I think is fantastic. And I think if this can broaden the reach for targeted therapy testing in rural areas that don't have access to specialty care, I think that's fantastic. So I think we need to be cautious that we don't get ahead of ourselves in terms of when this is right or when to apply this into our programs, but that we continue to look at this and figure out how it fits into everybody's workflow. And then obviously all of the financial and other issues that can be a challenge are addressed. But again, you know, I think what we need to state at the outset of all of these things is that there was an NIH consensus conference that said that lung cancer is detected late, we don't have good therapies, and the prognosis is poor, and that's just paraphrasing it. And this was in 1970. That was nearly 50 years ago. And up until a few years ago, almost everything that they said in that paper held true. Within the last 5 to 10 years, our advancements have been really rapid. So we need to really be encouraged by this increase in research interest, this increase in pharmaceutical, biotech, and clinical research interest, because I think it's a really exciting time in to be a part of lung cancer care.
Thank you very much. It's a great conversation, Jed.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Great to see you.
Thanks so much for joining me today for this Westwind podcast. We hope you'll be interested enough to subscribe either by checking out the options at beaconmedic.com or looking for West Wind Podcast on iTunes or wherever you find your audio content. Please take the time to submit a review, and we'd also welcome your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this is Dr. Jack West. Thanks for listening.